Donald Trump liked it better in the good old days when they called it England.
I have great respect for the UK, United Kingdom, great respect. People call it Britain, they call it Great Britain, they used to call it England, different parts.
Joining us now is Fintan O'Toole, a columnist for the Irish Times and The Guardian. He's the author of the new book, The Politics of Pain, Postwar England and the Rise of Nationalism. Well, Donald Trump would understand at least one word in the title. England is what he wants to call it. So it turns out Brexit is showing us it's not exactly a United Kingdom.
It sure is not. You know, it was interesting even, you know, Trump's formulation of it. He didn't know what to call it. And in a way, in his own kind of strange way, he was hitting on some kind of truth, right, which is that this is a conglomeration of nations. You know, you have Northern Ireland, you've got Scotland, you've got Wales, you've got England. And what we've been seeing slowly over the last 20 years is the English kind of coming up as an English nationalism, which you recognize in America. You know, this kind of nationalism is a real force. And it's very poorly articulated. It doesn't really know what it wants. And then somebody comes along and says, you know what you can do? You can kick the European Union. You know, we have an enemy over there, and that will help you define who you are. And if you just leave the European Union, then you'll be English and you'll be happy. And of course, it's not working out too well.
Yeah, and so in America, we watch Brexit. We are confused by it endlessly. We see these absolute deadlines that just disappear, and then there's another absolute deadline that appears. And so I've sensed that covering it as a day-to-day news developing story is an inadequate way of describing what's happening over there. That's why this book is so important, because you're going into a kind of social psychology of this place, especially this place that really is called England.
Yes.
That spot within the United Kingdom.
Yeah, yeah. You know, it's a very old nationality. It's a very powerful nationality. It's a very proud nation. They've every reason to be proud. You know, I'm not trying to undermine them or marginalize that identity at all. But, you know, they're obsessed with two things. One is the Second World War, which they still haven't really properly dealt with. If you listen to politicians now, they're still talking about Winston Churchill. They're still talking about Dunkirk. They're still talking about the Blitz. You know, they're using this language all the time, which means somehow they've never quite dealt with what I think is their problem, which is they were a big part of winning the Second World War, and then within 10 years, they're looking at Germany, Italy, Japan, doing better than they did. That didn't happen to America. I mean, America is booming, is, you know, coming into its own, really, after the Second World War, whereas the Brits are kind of declining, and they're losing empire. That's the other big thing, of course, that they've never really quite come to terms with. So you have these strange psychological constructs that are still there, and most of the time, people don't think about these things, right? You know, they just get on with their lives. But when somebody comes along and says, you know, you've got a problem here and I can solve the problem, I can give you an enemy, which will make you feel good about yourself if you just kick this enemy. And of course, this is why it's gone nowhere, because it has no positive content, right? It's just a negative proposition. It just says, leave the European Union and everything will be good. And then you find actually undoing 50 years of history is not that easy, in fact. And you need to know where you want to go. And I think the real English problem is they don't really know where they want to go.
Because you say they are caught in a conflict with their own sense of superiority and inferiority.
Yeah. I think, you know, people talk about what's the legacy of empire. You know, it's gone a long time. You think, surely this is over.
Yeah.
But the one thing that remains is a mentality. You know, in an empire, you are either the top dog or you're being kicked. You know? There's nothing in between. There's no normal state. And I think the English still apply this to themselves, right? So they ask the question, am I dominating this? And if I'm not, it must be dominating me. And this is, I think, became plausible with the European Union, where they could say, we don't dominate this thing, because they don't. It's a very complex thing with 28 countries. But if we're not dominating it, the only other possibility is that we're being really appallingly oppressed by it. And so you get this kind of self-pity and this ridiculous kind of charade, really, of saying, you know, this is like Hitler, it's like Stalin. I mean, it's ridiculously over the top in a way of thinking about yourself. And what the English find very hard is just to be normal. I mean, just to be what they are, which is a very decent, prosperous Western European democracy. That's not enough.
There's an incredible irony in what you describe as the last stage of British imperialism, in that one of the last hunks of imperialism, which is Northern Ireland, seized territory by the Empire.
Yeah.
That is the stumbling block, the thing that that no one knows how to make work within Brexit. Too complex to explain to our audience tonight, but it's so ironic that Northern Ireland is the thing that is holding England back from its desired Brexit, if it is still desired by a majority, which is unclear.
It's a great point, Lawrence, you know, because they don't really care about Northern Ireland. If you ask those people in England about it, you know, it was a nuisance when there was trouble, and now there's no trouble, and that's great, and they're just happy, that's fine, and you don't need to think about it anymore. Yeah. And during the whole Brexit referendum campaign, they just wouldn't talk about it. You know, it was really the thing you couldn't even mention. And it's the return of the repressed. I mean, the thing you won't talk about, of course, becomes the very thing that destroys your whole project. Why? Because it's real. It's a reality. In a lot of ways, Brexit's like a movie, you know, that they've written the script. It's a very simplistic kind of story. We break free from history, but nobody breaks free from history. History is real. And in our islands, you know, Ireland and Britain, where history really becomes real is Northern Ireland, because that's where you still have all of this stuff as a very active, live, dangerous thing. And it's made it impossible for them to escape. The last throw of the dice, and this is what Boris Johnson has just done, really, is dump Northern Ireland. Mm-hmm. So what he's done for his final Brexit strategy is basically say, Northern Ireland can more or less stay in the European Union, and we're going the other way. Yeah. Can you think of any other state that would ever do that? I mean, I know a lot of people maybe in New York might like to get rid of Alabama, but you wouldn't really ever say, you know, we're gonna build a border between Alabama and the rest of the United States. And that's essentially what Johnson's doing now. And of course, the irony of all of this is that it's a nationalist project that's going to end with the breaking up of their own state. The union really won't survive. And maybe Donald Trump will be right after all, you know, thinking, I don't know what to call it, because maybe in 10 years' time, we might be calling it something very different.
You cannot understand what's happening there without reading Fintan O'Toole and this psychological case, social psychological case. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Real honor to have you here. All of my real understanding of what's going on over there comes from you, and it should in our audience too. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Coming up, the billionaires versus Elizabeth Warren. Some billionaires are worried about the Warren wealth tax and what it could do to their nest egg.